افغانستان و پاکستان دو کشور در کنار هم با مشکلات عدیده خبرنگاری، اما فراتر از آن مسئله چگونگی نوسان روابط میان این دو کشور دست کم در یک دهه گذشته. رئیس جمهور کرزی گاه پاکستان را برادر خطاب میکند و گاه هم دشمن، و فراتر از آن مسئله چگونگی رابطه میان این دو کشور. زمان هم از موجودیت هراس افغان‌ها در خاک پاکستان صحبت میشه، زمان هم پاکستان در پی عزیز که حکومت افغانستان با استفاده از امکانات هندوستان در پی استفاده در مناطق بلوچستان و پشتون نشین پاکستان هستند. در این برنامه تعدادی از خبرنگاران پاکستانی و افغان را با خود داریم تا در موارد مختلف از جمله چالش های خبرنگاری در این دو کشور و همچنان چگونگی رابطه میان افغانستان و پاکستان صحبت کنند. ویلکم آل آف یو. خوش آمدید. Start from the journalism state or media state in Pakistan. What is the state of journalism and media in Pakistan?
Well, currently, if you're talking about, we have a very developed print media. There's a television channel boom also, which has started from 2002. And right now, there are over 50 channels in Pakistan, out of which there's a mix of entertainment and news channels. Then as far as you go to Urdu newspapers, which are the most read newspapers, there are lots of Urdu newspapers on regional and national basis. And then English newspapers are also coming up. There are two recent newspapers that have opened up. Express Tribune just opened up 2 years ago, which has probably you can say it has one of the largest readership online. So there's online media also coming in. So I think, I mean, because in 2000, before the 2000 decade, in the last 10 years, the media has really developed in Pakistan, because before that, it was only state-owned media television channels, which was only one channel and one radio channel. So I think in the last 10 years, we've really grown and we've become probably not very huge, but sort of a middle-tier industry now in Pakistan.
Last year, Pakistan was one of the dangerous, the first country which is dangerous for journalists. How do you see it now? What is the main challenge in front of journalists in Pakistan?
Well, yes, obviously, I mean, as far as 2001 is concerned, 9/11, which you guys are affected with also, in Pakistan also, the war on terror reporting is one of the most dangerous things to do. They're the tribal areas where there's active military operation happening, and that's where we've had the highest number of deaths of journalists happening. But also at the same time, there's a lot of military involvement in the country's politics. So that's one of the other things that a lot of journalists have to be careful about when they're reporting. Besides that, I think...
You see, Pakistan and Afghanistan, these are the countries that have been struck with war. And whenever you report on issues such as war, there's always risk related to it. And... no matter what, however, you know, the condition for journalists are, I believe these are the countries which attract reporters from around the world. Companies and organizations have been doing some efforts to protect their journalists, but I'm sure there's still more to do for journalists.
How about the behavior of Pakistani government with the media, especially with the journalists? How do you see it?
I think Pakistan has one of the most free and vibrant media, and our commentators on TV and our journalists very openly criticize the current government. And because there is democracy, the current government has to listen what the journalists are saying. So I think media is very much free. It's independent, it's vibrant, you can come out, you can write about it. But yes, there exists a problem. Just as my colleague Taha has mentioned, the army influence in few areas, and then also the problem of militancy, because when you are reporting from the tribal areas, you are very careful. If you're reporting against the militants, then you have a threat from them. If you're reporting against the, you know, maybe military in Balochistan or in some other area, you have a threat from that. So that threat exists. But overall, generally, in Pakistan, the media is very vibrant.
How is the behavior of Pakistani government, especially when you want to receive information from them?
I have no problem. I'm a reporter. I can go to any Pakistan's government office, and there's a good, big, developed institutes like Ministry of Information, Ministry of Foreign Office, etc. And every ministry has a spokesperson. You go, you communicate with them. Sometimes there is problem, there is bureaucracy. You might understand that. But overall, generally, it's not that difficult to get access to the leaders or the ministers or the important policy makers?
Thank you. If we compare it with Afghanistan, especially in the last one decade in here, which we have free media, how do you see it? How do you compare it with Pakistani media?
Well, like many other fields, journalism has changed a lot in Afghanistan. Indeed, it's a brand new phenomenon. Well, we had journalism in the past in Afghanistan, but the two decades of war, we lost everything, including journalism. But media and journalism has progressed and improved a lot in Afghanistan, and freedom of speech and media is one of the achievements of President Karzai's government. But still, we have a lot of challenges. As journalists, do not feel safe. We cannot to report certain things and touch certain issues or write about certain people. And also, there are areas of Afghanistan where we cannot travel to see everything from a close distance and listen to people who live there and who are faced with the challenges there.
Thank you. You?
I think we're comparing two medias. The Pakistani media, it's very institutionalized, it's very historical. There are papers that have been there for decades, whereas in Afghanistan, most of the papers and the TV channels we have are only a decade old, since 2001. But if you look at it, just the period of time that we have worked in, just 10 years, it's pretty impressive, the development and how robust the scene is. One point that I want to make in comparison between the two medias, the very institutionalized media of Pakistan, and the very infant media of Afghanistan ends up making the same mistakes, especially in using the language that we... Particularly when our media channels, on our TV channels, address Pakistan, sometimes they get emotional. They use sentimental language in news bulletins, which is problematic. It brings our professionalism into question. But Pakistani media that has been in work for decades does the same. So,
could you give an example?
For example, in our media and our very prominent TV channels, when they talk about Pakistan, they say Pakistan's God willing, Pakistan's evil agenda will not succeed in a news bulletin. For Pakistan, there was a headline, news headline recently, that said 20 or 15 people in Khyber Pakhtunkhwa were murdered, shaheed ho gaye, whereas under the same line, it was 21 people in Jalalabad, in Nangrahar, halak ho gaye. So,
I think we will give you to talk about this matter. You can.
So, I'll say that media is one of the biggest achievements that this government, this Karzai administration, should be proud of in Afghanistan. In the past one decade, we have a boom in media industry in Afghanistan, and relatively, Afghanistan respects the values of journalism, the Afghan government, and if you see, like you. Everybody knows that Pakistan is the most dangerous place for journalists.
Was the most dangerous place for journalists.
So, and that we can count in that relatively, compared to Pakistan, media is free in Afghanistan, relatively. I'm talking relatively. But we do have problems in Afghanistan. In media, we cannot travel. I was myself once abducted by Taliban in Kunar. So we do have problems, but if we compare Afghan media to Pakistani media, we do have our media is relatively better. And the other thing was that my colleague Mujib referred to was that Pakistani media would refer to Afghan people when they run some bombing or something like ahlak and to Pakistani shaheed. And there was another example. For instance, when Afghanistan was beaten by England in T20 World Cup, so I saw a headline, a Pakistani newspaper, in which they say that Afghanistan ke khwab World Cup ke khwab ka mahal chaknachur ho gaya, something like that. So that expressed the header of Pakistanis toward Afghanistan.
If we have an idea from you, all of you, about this topic, you can say it.
Yeah, when we compare the two media systems, we need to have a look at the media landscapes.
So if we it's not like we're not here to see which is better which is less, you know. So we need to see that how many TV channels are there, how many print, you know, newspapers are there in Afghanistan, in Pakistan, how many radio channels are there, and how much access they have in their provinces, in their villages. Do people have that access to information? Then we can say, okay, maybe by the end of the day, we'll get to know that Afghanistan and Pakistan both have the same policies. And being journalists, we should focus on that rather than bashing each other.
Sure. That's good. Next.
My name is Bari Baloch. I belong to Balochistan province of Pakistan. So we are talking, discussing about the freedom of media in both countries. I belong to Balochistan, where five military operations have carried out. So there are still many places in Balochistan where even the media, the access of media is not possible. So there are a lots of hurdles in the face of media persons to report, especially in Balochistan, where at least 24 journalists have been killed just during last 3 to 4 years.
Yeah, thank you. You can say very shortly.
Yeah, well, basically, when he talks about the language, right, I think that's an international phenomena. If you look at the tabloidism of news business, eventually you guys will also go to it. And as far as when you said the Pakistani media is old, yes, the newspapers are old, but the television channel is a decade old also. So we are seeing, and there is a lot of tabloidism that is happening, not just in Pakistan, but you see that in Europe, you see that in America, you know, the foxifying effect. So that is something which journalists like you should sift through, you know. I mean, you should see that this is just language. The content or the information is something else. So as far as information is concerned, for example, I have been reading the Afghan media, or I've been reading the Afghan newspapers. Here, there are direct accusations on Pakistan all the time. When you read the Pakistani newspapers or Pakistani news channels, we do have that direct accusation. We have India, for that matter. You know, there are in the very mainstream, you know, Urdu newspapers, they do that. They have that right-wing mentality. But you also see diversity. You see the extreme liberal side. For example, if you read Express Tribune or Dawn, or if you read the news is a little right-wing, but Express Tribune and Dawn, they will give you a comprehensive point of view of everything. But Geo, for example, is then again going towards tabloidism, which is also happening in India, which is happening all over the world. So language should not matter. For example, BBC has now established that they will not call anyone martyred or, you know, in that way. So you should, yes, those code of ethics or those language codes are still developing, but most of the media is going towards tabloidism.
Very shortly.
I agree. My point was in general, not criticizing the Pakistani media, just saying our infant media is making the same mistakes in terms of language as a very professional, institutionalized media is making as well. But I wanted to make one larger point about the sustainability of our media. If you look at the Pakistani papers and TV channels, most of them sort of have sustainable business models, whereas our media is still very donor-driven. A lot of the TV channels, a lot of newspapers get a big share of their budgets from donors. And going into 2014, the sustainability of that media is in question. And these are the larger topics that we should be also addressing.
Yeah, thank you. Add here. You see, we always talk about what's the problem in this media and that media, but we've never come to the solutions. Why is it happening? It's because we are directly not exchanging information and we're relying on other sources of media. We don't have reporters in Afghanistan and vice versa. So if we basically strategize on this issue and start cooperating with each other directly rather than depending on international media, I'm sure most of our problems and misunderstandings would end right there.
این بخش نخست برنامه در مورد چگونگی آزادی بیان و کار رسانه‌ای در افغانستان و پاکستان. حال در مورد چگونگی رابطه میان افغانستان و پاکستان. If you see the last decade relationship between Pakistan and Afghanistan, it's a swaying relationship. What caused that the government have swaying relationship, especially in the last decade in here?
You see, my point of view is completely different. If I cover Foreign Office of Pakistan, and I have been looking at Pakistan's foreign policy from last few years, and I clearly can see that Pakistan's policy towards Afghanistan has changed. Now, because of our mistakes in the past, people in Afghanistan still don't believe us. That's the problem, that our policy is changing. That's why there's such, we have made mistakes. And that's why, you know, you can obviously see the anti-Pakistan sentiment in the media and in public somewhat as well. But I now, I think as journalists, it's our duty to report what's actually happening on the ground.
Sure.
It's not, my understanding is, it's never going to be in the interest of Pakistan to have a destabilized Afghanistan. It's not going to help us.
When we concentrate in the main question about the relationship between Pakistan and Afghanistan government, we have swaying relationship, especially once President Karzai said Pakistan is our brother. Once President Karzai said Pakistan is our enemy. How do you see it? Why we have swaying relationship?
Can I say something? Sure. President Karzai can say this, but our prime minister is never going to say one day that Afghanistan is our brother. After 3 days, he's not going to say that we have bad relations with
our prime minister.
Our government policy, if you have been following Pakistani media and Pakistani channels and the statements of government officials from last 2 years, government officials have this consistently following this narrative that we need a stable Afghanistan.
Now,
thank you.
Case with
we will
and
let
Afghanistan.
You to talk about it. When we have from you, if you talk about the swaying relationship between Afghanistan and Pakistan, especially sometimes Afghan government directly said that the Pakistan played double game. How do you see it? Why?
Well, to some extent, I think they are telling the truth. The Pakistanis they're playing a double game in Afghanistan. On one side, they are playing the brother's role. On the other side, they're supporting the very people that the government is fighting against.
But she said, but never our prime minister said once Afghanistan is our brother and once Afghanistan is our enemy.
Well, maybe they're smarter. Maybe they're playing better politics than our politicians. They have been very, very smart. Pakistan have survived a lot of difficult times, and they've gone through a lot of difficult times, and it's because of their politicians. What we lack is good politicians with clear agenda and clear strategy.
Yeah, once should be clear that when we use Pakistan, it means Pakistani government. You?
No, yes. No problem.
Well, when he's talking about, as he said, that, you know, the Pakistani government is smarter, it's not about that. We have to realize that historically, in historical context, we've had military rule. Majority of the Pakistan's government, you know, has been a military rule. So the military has dominated the policies, and military has different interests than a democracy. Right now, we're seeing a democracy completing its tenure. We had a dictatorship before this, President Musharraf. His attitude would have been different.
You mean the policies changed?
Yes, and the policies have changed. And we have to realize the fact that when we talk about Pakistan's foreign policy, there is an influence of the military, which is not a very democratic institution, and which has ruled Pakistan still. So that is why we have these sort of mistrusts that have developed between Pakistan and Afghanistan, because the military acts in a very different way. It doesn't act in a civilian leadership way, which we are seeing now happening.
Thank you. It's really changed?
I completely agree with Mr. Siddique.
Taha.
That the consistency of the civilian government is in no doubt. The Pakistani civilian government has always said Afghanistan is a friend. And I have noticed the recent efforts to even better the relationship. But how much of the foreign policy is controlled by the Pakistani civilian government? And there's a lot of military influence, and we know that the military agenda for Afghanistan has not changed.
So
we
how
have
do you
seen
see
no
it?
Indication.
Now the policy of Pakistan against Afghanistan is made by civilian government or the military government?
I'd say for a long time in the future, it will still be the military. And
no? You said about.
Well, you know, Pakistan and Afghanistan are countries which has a lot of non-state actors having interest in these two countries. Our decisions are not independent. We have to be very true. Pakistan cannot take decisions independently, especially when it comes to international relations, especially Afghanistan and India, and vice versa.
So which country give decision?
Well, you know, we have stakeholders in both countries, and you know that we sometimes are being dictated, sometimes Afghanistan, and we have to be very careful. Number two, it's not only about Pakistan and Afghanistan. Politics, international politics, has always been swaying. We've had ups and downs with America. We've had ups and downs with India. We've had ups and downs with almost every country, and this is the way all other countries work.
Thank you. It is the same question when we talk about the swaying relationship So she said, it is usual.
As we said, as they said before, that Afghans never believe in Pakistan, and Pakistani policy has been changed. But what I see, what Afghans see here, they don't see, Pakistan does not give any reasons for Afghans, any reason for Afghans to believe that they're honest now. Okay. For instance, now they're saying that we want peace in Afghanistan, but at the same time, if you go to Quetta, this man is from Quetta, he's reporter of Quetta. If you go there, you can see Taliban like from Ghazni. I was in Ghazni a few weeks ago. They go to Quetta. There is a Quetta Shura. They get their command from there. The Taliban leadership is based in Quetta. So how does it work for Pakistanis? Like once they say that we want peace and we are making efforts, we do our best, but at the same time they're supporting, they're backing, and they're equipping Taliban, they're sending them to Afghanistan.
It should be clear that this discussion is not a debate which we support Afghan government and you support the Pakistani. We are colleagues and we just analyze truly.
Yes.
You can say, you. Please give the mic.
Only I want to add something that only from my point of view, the Pakistani government policy hasn't changed in towards Afghanistan. As we see that nowadays, especially about the border attacks, about the Pakistani security forces attacks on Kunar provinces, make a very difficult situation. And also nowadays in Afghanistan, so the people of Afghanistan ask the government to take decisive actions on Pakistani side.
Thank you. So next, you can. Please give the mic.
Hi, my name is Dilawjan. I work for the news in Peshawar. About the swing relations, as you said, you know, Karzai sometimes said that Pakistan is playing double game or is enemy. You know, I read the paper the other day and he said the same about the US, and the US is angry about that. And if you ask Pakistani, you know, diplomats, they will say the same about Afghanistan. You know, they said Afghanistan is playing double game. And, you know, that's clear from the policy that we conducted operation in Sawat Valley. And we evicted, you know, a terrible terrorist from there, Maulana Fazlullah. And he is hiding in Kunar for the last, like, 3 years. And he has been conducting cross-border attacks. So if you are asking Pakistan, like Afghanistan is asking Pakistan to take action against terrorists, well, fine. But then there is a duty of Afghanistan to take action against those terrorists who are hiding here. And you know that they are clearly launching attacks against the Pakistani villagers and Pakistani security forces. And those who are evicted from Bajol and in Waziristan and Momand Agency. I may name them, Maulvi Faqir, Waliur Rahman. They're all hiding in Kunar and other areas.
Yeah, thank you. Once again, it should be clear that there is not a debate which we criticize the governments by our own side. The other point is, you can add it. Yeah. I asked a question. Yeah. You can add it to those points that Mr. Mashal said about. What is the main problem between these two countries? When we said Pakistan play double game, Pakistani government said that Afghan government play double game and use from Pashtuns and Baluch in Pakistan. What is the problem?
It's a very simple problem. See, basically, I mean, we've been here for almost like we're going to be here for 10 days, and we met earlier Afghans also, and we read newspapers and we talk to people. The biggest problem, I think, according to me, is the cross-border movements. Everyone on this side says that people come from that side. Everyone on that side says people come from that side. So, I mean, there's a cross-border movement, and there's and yesterday we met the Pakistan ambassador. He said the cross-border movement is a problem. People prefer to go without visas, without documentation, and that is where the problem is. And it is a huge Durand line. It is 2,400 kilometers, if I'm not wrong. So because of that, it is a very porous border. And people come in from one side to the other and go back to, and that is what is creating the problem. I think we've seen a decade of war happening in Afghanistan, or, you know, reactions happening here. And then in Pakistan, we've had spillovers. We've had 35,000 people, civilians dying in Pakistan. So we're both victims. And I think we need to strategize our borders, make them not so porous. And
we will talk about the solution also. Yes. Mr. Mashal?
I wanted to...
When we talk about the relationship between Pakistan and Afghanistan, especially in the last decade, when we have swaying relationship, if we talk about the big challenge or big problem between the two countries, two governments, what is that?
I think the swaying has happened on this side only. The other side, the Pakistani side, has had a very consistent policy. And the swaying has happened in hopes that it will change that policy. And it hasn't. And the only way forward I see is that our government gets its house in order first, has a clear long-term vision for Afghanistan, and then try to work with Pakistan on cooperations, on incentives, especially on economic incentives that can stabilize the region. Right now, it's back-and-forth policy. It's very ad hoc. There's no clear vision where both Pakistan and Afghanistan can work towards stabilizing the region. It's just they're trying to change Pakistani policy, and it's not working, and it hasn't worked in 10 years. So we have to realize that it's not going to change. We have to take a better way to incentivize stability.
Yeah, thank you. You?
One thing that I completely fail to understand, or first let me focus on the solution. I think the number one problem why there's so much of trust deficit between two countries clearly is because of lack of information. You don't know what Pakistan is actually doing for Afghanistan. We don't know what Afghanistan is actually doing for Pakistan. For instance, somebody has mentioned here there were attacks from Kunar, from Pakistani border to Kunar. There have been very negligible casualties in Afghanistan, but you all must have read in the media that there were militants from Kunar that actually slaughtered Pakistani soldiers and that have killed Pakistani soldiers, but we don't hear about that in Pakistan. Let me just throw some light on the facts. There are more than 100,000 Pakistanis working in Afghanistan. Pakistan is desperate for energy. And if we have a stable Afghanistan, Iran, Pakistan gas pipeline, TAPI gas pipeline, Tajikistan, Afghanistan, Pakistan and India gas pipeline, and Kasa 1000, which is a very big electricity project. This cannot be successful for Pakistan if there's instability in Afghanistan. So for all economic needs, Pakistan needs a stabilized Afghanistan, Afghanistan where there's no war, no conflict. This is not... Economically, the things have changed. The government in Pakistan has realized we can't continue like this. Pakistan can't prosper.
Thank you.
We're aware that the war is slowly going to travel towards the time
from this side. If we talk about the information that she said, less information caused that we criticize each other countries. When we talk about the Konar province shelling from Pakistani government or Pakistani government said about the Afghan government, but really it caused that the less information caused that we criticize each other. I mean government.
What I think is that there should be no restriction on information. Recently, Afghanistan put a ban on Pakistan newspaper and the border provinces, Abkunur, eastern provinces, and Khos. But a couple of years ago, I would say there was a ban on Afghan TVs and Peshawar and Islamabad, Quetta. I don't know about Islamabad, but in the Pashtun populated areas.
They cannot watch
Afghan TVs. Yes. And that was what I say, that both countries should respect freedom of media and freedom of law equity. As an observer, I say Pakistan put a ban on Afghan TV channels and don't let Pashtuns to watch Afghan TVs. Afghan TVs in their own language, Pashto language in Peshawar or Quetta. So they should expect Afghan government to put ban. They should expect a backlash from Afghan government. And that's what Afghan government did. Beside that, Afghan government has a very good reasoning for that, which is like they use Pakistani newspaper being used as... and are still using as Taliban propaganda. I'll tell you something else about Pakistan newspaper. I've read Wahdat, Khabruna, those Pashto, and also Mashriq, Kausab, those dailies. They will quote, instead of officials, there was a bombing in Kabul. So they will not quote first Afghan officials. Instead, they will quote Taliban. And Taliban exaggerates all the time. So that's not what the journalists should support. That's what should we talk about. And that's what we should solve and we work.
Do you agree?
To sort it out.
I have three answers to this. Number one, Afghan channels are not banned in Pakistan. The issue is of landing rights. If you sit on the table with us, ask for licenses, and get your landing rights, Afghan channels will be allowed in Pakistan. Number two, the newspapers that you're talking about, 15 Urdu, very low-circulated newspapers, which we even don't call newspapers, we call them hate literature. In Pakistan, we call anything which is giving way to Talibanization or terrorism, we call it hate literature. We don't even want to call it newspapers. They were stopped, and they're even banned in Pakistan. Even the circulation of those hate literature is banned. Number two, we talked to the Interior Ministry here, and they said only 15 papers were blocked. We talked to our embassy, and we were told that no English newspaper mainstream can pass through the border post. So there's a conflict between institutions from here. Now that we're personally here, we're not depending on any second-hand information. So this is what we need to clear first. Pakistan mainstream media is not spreading hate against Afghanistan.
When we talk about the first-hand information, especially in Afghanistan, shelling on corner, a ban of media, what is the truth?
Well, we are getting all those information from the ground, from the local people. Our information is more credible because a lot of newspapers, especially in international media who are operating in Afghanistan, they have stringers everywhere. They have people, locals, who go to the villages and remote areas where something happens, and they get their information firsthand. I would like to point out to a couple of issues. Our friend said that Pakistan has been fighting a war on terror. I'm afraid I disagree. Even when it comes to Afghanistan, is not the only issue that Pakistan has a double policy for. Even when it comes to war on terror and war against extremism, Pakistan has a policy, a double game policy. So they are fighting against some of the Taliban, but they are supporting some others. So we can say that there are Taliban in Waziristan that the government is fighting against, but there are Taliban who are supported by the government of Pakistan.
Thank you.
What she said about Pakistan's desire to have a stable Afghanistan, beside it. That's what maybe the people of Pakistan believe in desire for, and what the civilian government wants. But the Pakistani military doesn't want that.
And now, do you think more power energy is in the hand of military or the
totally
civilian government?
If you talk about, you mentioned energy and trade and job opportunities and these stuffs. And let's not forget that the Pakistani army, and especially the ISI, they don't care about the Pakistanis either.
First, this is very important. I'm coming back to the swing relationship between Pakistan and Afghanistan. I believe it boils down to the inability or deadly inability of both countries to curb the movement and freedom of movement of the insurgents group or their affiliates in the border region of Afghanistan and Pakistan. And of course, that's very natural reaction, when there is a spike in the movement and the Afghan people, the Afghan army, national army, and Afghan police are inflicted high casualties, President Karzai, they will have to say, well, Pakistan is not our friend. But one thing is very important, we have to acknowledge that President Karzai, he explicitly stated that if there is conflict between the United States and Pakistan, Afghanistan will back Pakistan. It had reactions on the American side. He said, we are giving blood, but Afghanistan, it's not necessary for President Karzai to say this, but he said it on the national TV station. So this is very important. And Pakistan has been shelling Afghanistan for the past few months, and President Karzai has been repeatedly saying that we're not going to shell Pakistan back because people who are living across the border are also our brothers and sisters. Therefore, we have to give some credit to President Karzai.
Thank
it's
you
very important. And
thank
one
you
thing more, we cannot agree, neither the panel nor the participants here, we cannot agree on the common common things that we have the challenges. We should agree here first so people, politicians, can agree on the real world.
It's
practiced and believed that media is the most powerful pillar of a state. Even in Pakistan, we are not having the same democratic government as we are having. As powerful democratic government in Pakistan as we are having comparing with the Afghan one. Our media is centralized, controlled by the military establishment. It's true. We saw many channels sold, and it was we got a huge leakage that a malak and a merchant, a trader, bought the anchors, the TV, the whole team, and using against one and other. On the other side, it's clear that Pakistani media is always having hate literature in Quetta. Even we are having many democratic and nationalist parties, the governments in Quetta and other regions of Pakistan.
Yeah.
But they are not having, they are not given the news, and they are ignored. On the other hand, the terrorist and banned organizations are gotten in Super League.
Thank you. باید یک بار دیگر یادآوری کرد که این مسائلی که بیشتر به عنوان نگاه مطرح میشه نگاه خبرنگارانی است که در مورد سیاست گذاری هایشون و برداشت هایی که سیاست گذاری این دو کشور در قبال مسائل افغانستان و پاکستان وجود داره مطرح میشه و هیچگاه دیدگاه حکومت های این دو کشور نیست. بخش سوم برنامه بیشتر متمرکز به چگونگی رابطه استراتژیک میان افغانستان و پاکستان است. رئیس جمهور کرزی میگوید که در پی امضای معاهده استراتژیک با پاکستان است. آیا این واقعا درد موجود را دوا خواهد کرد؟ When we talk about the nowadays President Karzai's speech about the strategic pact with Afghanistan and Pakistan, how do you see it? It will be useful, effective for clear the misunderstanding or everything which said Beenish President Karzai or Pakistani government?
Well, I think, I mean, the strategic pact, again, it's usually, you know, lip service at times. The problem with between, like what we've been discussing here, has been the problem of terrorism in both countries. It's a reality. Nobody can deny it. I have been told that if I go from Kabul to South, and as these reporters were saying, they cannot travel to some areas in Afghanistan. They're Afghans. Why cannot they travel? In the same way, in Pakistan, there are some areas in tribal areas or Balochistan, as he mentioned, we cannot travel. So this region has a terrorism issue. There is insurgency. We have to realize that, and we have to take this as a reality. As far as the strategic pact is concerned, yes, it's a good move from the Afghan government. Also, and Pakistani government is also involved in this. But then again, we have to understand that, as he said earlier, it's the civilian and the military difference. So the Afghan government needs to mature itself also to that level to understand that, okay, are we talking to the civilian leadership? Like the U.S. has done, like other countries are doing, for example, with India right now, the Pakistani civilian leadership is taking the front seat and is bringing both countries together. So in the same way, Afghanistan needs to realize that it's the civilian leadership. If they keep looking at the military, and also because of the insurgency, also because of the terrorism, then these problems will keep on happening.
Thank you. Mr. Mashal, do you think it is a good move which Afghan government wants to sign a strategic pact with Pakistan? And it will be the solution, especially when we talk about the misunderstanding or everything which we said about the relationship between Pakistan and Afghanistan?
I agree with Mr. Taha on this. It's not clear who the strategic pact is being signed with, who is on the other side, and if it's the civilian government, does the civilian government of Pakistan has the military on board on what they're signing? Because the civilian government will be gone in a few months, you have elections, but the military will be there. The consistency of the military policy will be there. And unless we convince the Pakistani military that what we are signing is to their benefit, it addresses their legitimate concerns. Pakistani military does have legitimate concerns. Sometimes on the Afghan side, we tend to ignore it. But yes, they do destructive work in Afghanistan. But at the same time, if you look beyond that, they have some legitimate concerns that need to be addressed. And we can only address those concerns if we have a clear vision for Afghanistan. And only if we know what we're signing, who we're signing this pact with, then we will know its effectiveness.
So when we talk about the legitimate concern, what is that?
It's India. India is investing heavily in Afghanistan. It's Pakistan's backyard. And Pakistan, considering India as their arch enemy, is concerned. It's fearful. They want guarantees from Afghanistan. And on the Afghan side, we need to have a clear vision for how we want to, what kind of a relationship we want with Pakistan. So Pakistan can understand that they don't need to fear Afghanistan becoming an India hub, becoming a threat to them from the Afghan side.
Let us know, when we talk about the relationship between Pakistan and India and Afghanistan and Pakistan, it is thought that the nowadays war in Afghanistan, insurgency, is a proxy war between Pakistan and India. What Mr. Mashal said about the concern, legitimate concern of Pakistan, do you think it is really caused?
What I've been trying to speak about is that things on the ground, the geopolitical situation is changing, and with that, the thinking in Pakistani government and military has also, it has forced them to change, even if they didn't want to change. And I can give you an example. When I was saying that we had made mistakes, by that I meant that Pakistan military had made mistakes. We created this monster, and now this monster has, you know, it's come in front of our face, and we are badly, badly affected by it. More than 35,000 Pakistani people, more than 5,000 Pakistan military people have lost their lives in this war. We don't want this anymore. So the Afghanistan, who have become rich in Afghanistan, had started their business in Pakistan as Afghan refugees. So India, and with India, our government is actually trying to improve its relations so that India is not a problem.
Do you agree?
I'm afraid I disagree. I think the India phenomena is playing an important role in the foreign policy of Pakistan and the relationship between two countries. It's because of the paranoia that the Pakistanis have from the influence of India in Afghanistan that they have even jeopardized their own stability and security by supporting extremist groups, which is threatening, you know, the very existence of the Pakistani state and Pakistani people. So I think the Pakistani phenomena is very, very important, and it plays an important role.
Now you?
Pakistani people are dying. Pakistan's army is losing
as well.
Its people.
Please let...
You know, we're losing our people, we're losing our army men, we don't want to be killed. How can we support extremism if our own people are being killed?
When you said we, it means Pakistani government.
Pakistani yes. government, Pakistani people, Pakistani institutions, everything.
Yeah, you add it, please.
Mr. Mashal said before that Indians' presence in Afghanistan is a legitimate concern of Pakistan, and I disagree. Because Afghanistan is an independent country. Afghanistan can deal with
every country,
yeah. whomever. Pakistan cannot tell that you can't deal with India because India is our enemy or whatever.
Definitely.
So Afghanistan is an independent country. But there is a fear among the Pakistani military and Pakistani establishment that the presence of Indians in Afghanistan will hurt Pakistan for some reason. And there is another thing I wanted to go back to that strategic pact thing. We already have certain numbers of agreements with Pakistan, and there is trade agreement, and Pakistan does not respect that. We have been following the news of Afghan traders, Afghan convoys, commercial convoys coming through a Karachi port, and they were stuck there like APTA pact, and they don't respect. So first, I think Pakistan should respect those pacts which are already signed with them. And at the second stage, Pakistan should give a reason to Afghans to believe them that they're honest
Thank
this
you.
Time.
It then really Pakistani be. Government should respect the pacts which signed with the Afghan government?
Afghans and Pakistan both have to realize that it's transition to democracy, and they both have to respect each other's democratic institutions. If Pakistan will not respect Afghan government, whether it's Mr. Karzai or anyone else, we should stop accusing each other that you're weak, you're immature, you don't know each other. The same goes to Afghanistan. They have to respect that there's a civilian democratic government. Talk to our civilian leaders. They are representatives of the, you know, citizens, not the army. Stop engaging with them. If you'll stop, then you'll, you know, get your real answer.
Yeah, thank you. You can, Mr. Wafoi. Yeah, there's no problem. Shortly. اگر کوتاه بکنید فرق نمیکنه به فارسی دیدگاهتان. مایک نزدیک بگیرید.
درست. در دیداری که دیروز با آقای محمد صادق سفیر پاکستان داشتیم با گروهی از خبرنگاران افغانستان و پاکستان اونا در مورد امضای معاهده پیمان استراتژیک با پاکستان که توسط آمد کرده مطرح شد میگفت که ما هیچ گونه نیازی نداریم که با افغانستان معاهده امضا بکنیم وقتی که یک سفیر نماینده دیپلمات پاکستان نماینده ارشد سیاسی پاکستان در افغانستان این را مطرح میکنه که ما نیازی به امضای پیمان نداریم چگونه معتقد باشیم که اونها پابند میشه به وعده‌ای که در پیمان ذکر میشه و بعد وقتی پرسیدیم که شما اگر احتمالا امضا شوه چقدر پابند هستین به این گفته‌هایتان که در پیمان ذکر میشه گفت ما وقت نیازی نداشته باشیم به امضای پیمان خب ما مهم است که ما مثلا حکومت افغانستان پابند به امضای هم چک پیمان نیست و ما نیازی هم نداریم که به حکومت افغانستان دست راست بکنیم و امضا کنیم
مستر وفایی سید وچ دی پاکستان امبسادر یسترده اور میبی تودی سید تو دی جورنالز دت وی دو نات نید فور دی ساین اف دس پاکت اند مستر وفایی سید ون دی دو نات نید هاو دی اکسپت اور هاو دی ریسپکت the other pacts which you signed with the Afghan government?
Well, first of all, I might not be present there. He didn't say this in front of us, so I cannot comment on that. To his my fellow's question, no one can take Pakistan's place in the Afghan market. We're not afraid of India, especially in a country where the Indian embassy is made of Pakistani cement. We're not afraid of India.
You?
I want to... that fellow of mine said that... we should deal, Afghanistan should deal with Pakistani civilian administration. But here's the question, that what is the civilian administration in Pakistan? They do not have any authority. We've been following news in Pakistan. And the army, the military establishment, the inter-service intelligence of Pakistan, they are self-sufficient. They can make, like, they do not need the civilian government to pay their salaries.
What is the civilian government in Pakistan?
Civilian government in Pakistan, again, I seem to be repeating myself again and again. The civilian government is very recent. You have to understand there was a military dictatorship. As far as the structures are concerned, for example, I was very surprised today. I was talking to one of the colleagues here, and she told me in Mazar Sharif, the governor there is a warlord. He's a former, you know, part of, he was a commander. So, you know, so there is reintegration in happening here. In Pakistan, the problem is, yes, we keep again and again, we are also criticizing the same thing. We had the Osama bin Laden problem. He appeared in a house way next to the military academy. Yes, we do have those problems. And we are pointing them out as media persons. We're not from the military, we're not from the government. As media persons, I've written extensively about it. I've written extensively against the military at times when there is a need to criticize it. For example, for the Osama bin Laden, when the one-year anniversary happened, I wrote an opinion piece saying that the military, nobody resigned from the military, nobody. So we do criticize our own
so
military.
So do you think now the military government in Pakistan especially reintegrated? Ongoing or reintegration
well,
is ongoing?
See, there is a problem. For example, when these terrorist attacks happened, the last terrorist attack, the big one that happened was at an airbase. There were two military soldiers which were court-martialed from that. So yes, the military is also cleaning its act. But obviously, because it has such a big hangover of the last 20, 30 years of supporting such elements at times because of its own strategic reasons and a military rule in the country, so it had absolute power. Yeah. So it was making those decisions. But yes, now looking forward, we should look forward. And looking forward, we think that if this democratic transition happens, as Kuratul N. Zaman was also saying, we're all in transitions. And these transitions need to happen. And in probably in 5 years from now on, we will all probably be agreeing and this talk show might not happen.
Do you agree?
I wanted to address one more point about the monster that Pakistan is facing today, the threat from. I think we shouldn't be clouding and blurring the narrative. There are two separate monsters. The one inside Afghanistan, we know very well that has links to the Pakistani ISI and the Pakistani military. So this monster, Pakistan is not fighting against. The monster that Pakistan is facing a threat from is an internal monster. It's a separate monster. That it is sort of a branch
and
of this monster.
Many monsters.
Many monsters.
Give me the time, please.
But there's an older monster that Pakistani government, not Pakistani government, Pakistani military has a history of supporting. And there's a monster they're fighting against now. So we shouldn't cloud and combine the monsters together.
Both of these monsters are now very well connected. So if one monster is our enemy, the other monster is definitely now our enemy.
But the monster
that... Because these two monsters are now working against the Afghanistan government and against
the
Pakistan government.
But here's the thing. The thing is that the monster that the Pakistani government is supporting and backing is not doing anything destructive in Pakistan. This monster is directly at the Afghan government in Afghanistan, whereas the monster they're fighting against is a very internal monster. So the monsters have different policies.
Okay, one shortly?
Yes, very shortly. Number one reason why, when I say that Pakistan doesn't want to support Taliban or doesn't want to support Afghan Taliban, is because there definitely is going to be a spillover effect. And that's the only reason why I've used the word monster, because we are facing the spillover effect. And the strategy has completely failed.
Can I see any examples of a spillover effect? Because I'm not convinced that the Afghan Taliban are doing anything inside Pakistan.
Well, the recent death toll has...
There are
so many monsters here, that is true, but again, it's a regional problem.
Thank you, it will give you time.
I would like to come back to one point. She made a point that Pakistan is not concerned about the influence of India because the cement that the Indians use is Pakistani.
Indian embassy
in Afghanistan is a concern of Pakistani government. Say it clearly.
It's not a concern.
No, they're saying there was just a comment cement.
I'm talking about the cement. Constructed.
Yeah.
Talking about the trade.
Let him. I don't want to be rude, but she needs to check her facts, because Pakistan's foreign policy is based on what India is doing in the region. Kashmir, Afghanistan are two most important regions where both countries are fighting, and everybody is trying to influence. And you mentioned that nobody can take Pakistan's place when it comes to Afghanistan. That's true. That, you know, we need Pakistan because we don't have a corridor to water and sea. We need Pakistan.
Thank you.
India is trying to replace Pakistan in Afghanistan, and that's a big concern for the Pakistanis.
Thank you. بیننده این ویژه برنامه با خبرنگاران افغان و پاکستانی است. دیدگاهی که بیشتر مطرح میشه مربوط به کسایی هستند که به عنوان یک خبرنگار آزاد مطرح می کنند، نه به عنوان نماینده های حکومت پاکستان یا حکومت افغانستان. حالا این بحث ها ادامه پیدا کرد و گفته شد که نگرانی های خاص خود را پاکستان در مورد افغانستان داره و افغانستان همچنان و در مورد چگونگی فعالیت رسانه ها در این کشور. آخرین سوالی که بیشتر مطرح میشه با این سوی تفاهماتی که بیشتر مطرح میشه، چگونه میشه این دو حکومت و در مجموع ملت های این دو کشور با هم نزدیک شوند؟ How it is possible between here the nations and the governments of two countries?
Can you repeat your question?
شکرانستم. یکی از خبرنگاران در شهر مزار شریف. به نظر ما تا زمانی که چالش ها و بحرانی که میان افغانستان و پاکستان وجود داره حل نگرده، ما نمیتونیم که همچو پیمان استراتژیک یا رابردی بین افغانستان و پاکستان به امضا برسانیم.
حالا در کل اگر مد نظر بگیریم، فکر میکنید واقعا چه مؤلفه هایی میتونه رابطه بین این دو کشور در قدم اول و در مجموع ملت های این دو کشور که بیشتر متاثر از چگونگی سیاست گذاری حکومت هایشون شده به وجود بیاید؟
خب در قدم نخست باید حکومت افغانستان چالش های بحرانی که در بین افغانستان و پاکستان وجود داره باید را مرفوع بسازه، چون ما به عنوان خبرنگار افغان از نشر همچو برنامه‌ای در مورد پاکستان که هر روز انفجار است، انتحار است و عملات بالای ولایت افغانستان است، خسته شدیم از نشش. حکومت افغانستان باید نخست جدی تصمیم بگیره در این مورد و این بحران هر چی زودتر با پاکستان حل بسازه. بعد از اون میتونیم که ما با پاکستان و همچون کشورهای دیگه پیمان استراتژیک بسازیم.
It is the last question. When we talk about the misunderstanding between the two governments, when the President Karzai once said Pakistan is our brother, once said Pakistan is our enemy, it is under mind of Afghan people that who is Pakistan, or when the Pakistani government have concern about the Indian influence in Afghanistan, about the something policies which Afghan government following here, especially when said about the support of Baluchs and Pashtuns by Afghan government, that the Pakistani government has concern about, how we can change this atmosphere and make up a policy which two governments and two nations get closer?
Well, I think it comes back to our original thing, as this is the conclusion. Here we are sitting as media men. Obviously, after this, we've also met with Afghan journalists. I think it has to do with a lot of media exchange. The information exchange has to happen. Right now, we're being fed by foreign papers on both sides. I also work for a foreign organization, but there is a lot of foreign reporting going on, which is being decided in New York, or which is being decided in London, or, you know, in all over the world. So, and we are 4 hours away. You know, if you go from Peshawar, you cross Torkham, and then you come into Afghanistan, and there is no, you know, there is no exchange of information from both sides. I think if these mistrust, these misunderstandings need to go, it needs to go away from exchange of information at media level, and the media development should happen exactly in the same way that we're doing right now. I'm sure these journalists sitting here, I will interact with them after the television show. I will talk to them and keep in touch with them. So this is what we need to do to develop an understanding which
and
is
get
better.
Closer.
Yeah.
Mr. Mashal, how is it possible?
I agree absolutely on the information front, but I also think it's a matter of vision as well. On the Afghan side, the government has no clear vision for sustainability of the country after 2014. And there's an opportunity in that right now, because Pakistan is facing a similar crisis as we are in terms of energy and economy. And if we put our way forward based on that economic incentives and economic cooperation, because it's a common problem we're sharing, then on the Afghan side, we need to have a clear vision for that. We don't have an economic vision at all. On the Pakistani side, we need to convince our friends on the other side that this is the way forward.
Thank you. اگر کوتاه اشاره بکنن، چگونه ممکن است این رابطه ها بیشتر نزدیک شود؟
در قدم نخست، از نظر ما اگر رابطه باید نزدیک شود، اگر ملت پاکستان از وضعیت افغانستان آگاه شود، جناب کرزای صاحب در دوستی خود اگر میخواهد که در عمل پیاده کنه، در قدم نخست، رسانه هایی که در پاکستان بند است باید رسانه ها آزاد شوند، نشراتشان آزاد شوند و دوم عملاتی که بالای راکت هایی که بالای ولایت ننگرهار پرتاب میشه ایره بند بسازند.
تشکر. What is your opinion about?
I think the best way forward is more Afghan, just as my other colleagues have mentioned, more Afghan journalists come to Pakistan, more Afghan parliamentarians should come to Pakistan, more Afghan government officials should come to Pakistan and interact with the civil society. We are not doing that. And get a better understanding of what the Pakistani government on the ground is saying. And if our voice becomes stronger, if you have an opinion, come and see, meet with Pakistan military officials. We should come more to Afghanistan often. And I think by bridging the gap, there's a lot of potential. We are neighbors. Pakistan can't go anywhere. Afghanistan can't go anywhere. Most Afghans have benefited from Pakistan. Pakistan can benefit immensely from Afghanistan. Let's try to convince our governments that we have to work together.
So much for coming.
I must tell this, that until both government do not forget what they have done previously and do not forget what they what they did as a mistake, then the relationship will not be better.
That's true.
I agree with my friend about the information exchange, but there are two most important points that I want to talk about here. One is that both countries, Pakistan and Afghanistan, they should work on building trust. There are certain conditions that Afghanistan have for Pakistanis, and there are certain conditions that the Pakistanis have for Afghanistan. So unless those conditions are met by both sides, I don't see a bright future for two countries. And also, I think media plays an important role here. In both countries, media should encourage people to democratize their country, because I believe that democratization comes from the bottom of the pyramid in a society. We saw many examples in Middle East. People stood up against their dictators, against military regimes, and they toppled them.
Thank you.
We can do that.
Thank you.
Yeah,
shortly, please.
You exactly. But then again, the more trust we develop, you know, we have to first start trusting our governments, you know, because when we start developing trust, something is done by either of the government which has an effect on us. So first of all, we should understand that we're not representatives of government here. We are here as transparent individuals, and we have to take the responsibility for transparent and truthful information exchange.
How it is possible to make trust?
I agree with all my fellows, but I would add something that first we need to, on media level, here respect the value of journalism, not publish the literature pattern. And at second, the most important stage is that that's very simple. Pakistan should stop interference in Afghanistan. That's it. That's the end to all the problems in
Thank
Afghanistan.
You. سپاسگزار از همه دوستانی که به عنوان خبرنگار از پاکستان و از افغانستان در این برنامه حضور داشتند. تا فرصت دیگر خدا نگهدار.